Hey guys, it's Lady and welcome back to this series of videos where I break down everything about our favorite Genshin characters. From stories unlocked via raising companionship levels, to voice lines said by other characters, to appearances in event quests, and so on. In other words, whether you don't have a specific character, can't be bothered to raise their companionship levels, need a refresher, or just want the basic TLDR of a character's text, then this ultimate lore guide is for you. Thanks to the main event in patch 2.2, in this video we'll be focusing on the rock and roll pioneer from Liyue, Xinyan. So let's begin by going over the lore in her character stories unlocked via companionship leveling. I just think this info will provide better context to Xinyan's actions during her actual appearances in-game that we'll discuss later. So with that said, probably the most notable thing about Xinyan is that she's a bona fide rock and roll gal that's doing her absolute darndest to establish the genre in Liyue. You see, rock and roll originated in Fontaine, actually, with Xinyan discovering it solely by chance. For a girl who never felt like she fit in at Liyue Harbor, rock and roll's themes of fighting against prejudice truly resonated with her and became her number one passion. But what was it about Xinyan's childhood that made her feel like she didn't belong? Well, there were quite a number of reasons, actually. For one, she was born into a poor family in which her parents poured everything of what little they had into their daughter, with the hopes that she'd rise like a phoenix. Xinyan eventually would, of course, though not in the way they expected her to. You see, they envisioned her as a fine, respectable lady, one who was good at traditionally feminine arts like cooking, household chores, and needlework. But Xinyan was no natural at any of these skills. Additionally, her physical appearance as a child wasn't traditionally feminine nor cute, which was just an added layer of disappointment for her parents. Rock and roll has become the outlet it is for Xinyan because of how deeply her own parents' prejudice impacted her childhood. However, she also firmly believes in never giving up just because things don't come naturally to you at first. Because that, in and of itself, is a form of prejudice thinking. And so, Xinyan kept diligently practicing those household arts, to the point that you'd now be shocked at how skilled she is at them. Especially since it's such a contrast to her fiery rock and roll image. In fact, the famous opera singer Yunjin, who's a huge fan of hers, visited Xinyan's home once and was stunned at all the handmade home ornaments, the cooktop that appeared regularly used, and just how clean and tidy it was overall. Clearly moved by this tangible example of how Xinyan refuses to allow prejudice to define her, this home visit only intensified Yunjin's support of the rock and roll star. But speaking of such dedicated fans, it certainly didn't start off that way for Xinyan. In fact, her rock and roll roots in Liyue were nothing but rotten tomato reviews. The literal kind. Even though she poured her heart and soul into the world of music, breaking many an instrument and forming hardened calluses on her fingers along the way, the only reaction she drew was ire from Liyue's citizens. In those early days, there were times when she considered leaving for a place that appreciated rock and roll. But then she had an epiphany. Wouldn't that be giving in to prejudice and be a betrayal to rock and roll itself? So, Xinyan decided she'd become the flame that'd light up Liyue Harbor. And with a renewed determination, she returned to the top of Mount Tianhong every single day to practice. She even began experimenting with fire, in the forms of sparks and explosions to liven up her performances. This was no mean feat for an ordinary person who had no vision, and she returned home many nights with burnt fingers. But her dedication seemed to reach the gods themselves. Perhaps having a great expectation for this music to spread across all seven nations, they bestowed upon Xinyan the finishing touch to her act, a boiling hot pyro vision. The moment it appeared, everything clicked, and she raced down the mountain and put on the first rock and roll concert to really take off in Liyue Harbor. Though, regarding the fire produced from her vision during her shows, well, it'd often be responsible for setting her impromptu stage aflame about halfway through her performances. A pile of charcoal would be the only thing left of it, which resulted in safety citations issued time and time again by the Millilith. Xinyan's pyrotechnics became so commonplace that the soldiers began tightening their patrols in an effort to put a stop to her performances. But Xinyan's rock and roll took root in a good number of these soldiers and managed to infect them with the spirit of rock and roll. These loyal fans, who Xinyan dubbed Friends of Rock, would notify her of the Millilith patrol routes and plans always ahead of time. And since Xinyan was so skilled at setting up her stage quickly from all that practice, she could have a raucous show going before the soldiers could even find her location in the first place. The Millilith were tired out eventually from their lack of results, and since there was no evidence of citizens being harmed in her performances, they've settled on an out-of-sight, out-of-mind policy towards them for the time being. Now, the funny thing is, even though Xinyan has her fair share of fans in Liyue now, she's still often judged for her appearance when she's just out and about running errands. Her naturally fierce appearance, coupled with the stage costume she wears daily to keep herself in the right frame of mind for her music, gives her quite the intimidating air. Even though she's practiced friendly facial expressions countless times in the mirror, many people still back away when they see her coming. One time she even saved a kid from a bunch of bullies, and gave him a friendly smile and gentle head pat to cheer him up. Though unfortunately for Xinyan, he ended up peeing his pants because he was so scared of her. Being Xinyan really is suffering sometimes. But now I think it's a good time to move on to Xinyan's actual appearances in the game. The first of which only happened just recently in patch 2.1's main event, since Xinyan hasn't been in any Archon or character story quest so far. Maybe in Fontaine? Question mark? So, in part 2 of the Moonlight Merriment event, Xiangling is seeking out Beidou's opinion on the 3 dishes she plans to enter into the Moonchase Festival's cooking competition, when she's also lucky enough to catch Xinyan at the exact same place. Xinyan's third story unlock actually details how she and Xiangling have been friends for a long time. So, you know how we just talked about Xinyan's appearance and how it intimidates a lot of people? Well, Xiangling is one exception. And actually, Xinyan has been a helpful taste tester for the Wanmin chef's craziest experiments. The never-before-seen flavors often serve as great flashes of musical inspiration for the rock and roll pioneer. So yeah, the two go back a long way. And same with Beidou for the both of them. But anyway, both Beidou and Xinyan think the 3 dishes Xiangling serves them taste fantastic, though they seem to miss that certain oomph, or in Xinyan's musical lingo, beat, that could take them to a whole nother level. Both Xinyan and Beidou prefer food that's packed with flavor, so the fact that all 3 of the dishes are on the milder side is the one point of critique they can offer Xiangling. Said chef greatly values their input and is left with some great encouragement from the fiery Shinyan. Legit, everyone should want a hype woman like our pyro musician. Now, the only major role Shinyan has in any quest is from patch 2.2's main event, the Labyrinth of Fog. We find her waiting outside the Tenryou Commission's headquarters and learn that she's been invited to Inazuma for the Iridescence Tour, a huge music festival that's a big deal in Fontaine, but was set to be held in the land of Electro this year. But unfortunately, the festival organizers ran into trouble on the open ocean and ultimately won't make it in time, meaning the Iridescence Tour has been officially cancelled. What's even worse news for Shinyan is that her temporary travel permit in Inazuma is set to expire in just one day, and now there's no way to get a new one issued from the festival organizers. Thankfully, Shinyan's got the traveler as a connection, cause thanks to everything they've done for Inazuma, they're able to meet with Kujo Sara herself. It turns out the Tenryou Commission has been so busy because a new mysterious domain just popped up out of nowhere. Shinyan and the traveler offer to lend a hand in exchange for Shinyan's new travel permit. Then they head off to the domain's supposed location. There they find a strange paper doll on the ground. And because Shinyan has familiarized herself with all sorts of myths and legends from all over Teyvat for musical inspiration, she recognizes the doll as a Shikigami. The doll is actually alive and introduces himself as Shiki Taisho, the overseer of this domain, though that's all he knows. He doesn't even remember what the purpose of this domain is. They're hoping entering the domain may awaken some of Shiki Taisho's memories, though before they all head in, Shinyan pulls Traveler aside for a quick private chat. She has some reservations about Shiki Taisho right now, but mentions she has a way to test people's sincerity. All via her music. Shinyan believes music is an honest language that tests the true depths of the heart. So she legit whips out her instrument right then and there and plays a short tune. Since Shiki Taisho has a similar response to the music as her good friends Beidou and Shanling, Shinyan is willing to trust him. Then they enter the Onmyo chamber and are surprised to find someone else already there. And guess who it is? It's Child! Shinyan happens to believe Paimon's on-the-fly made-up background for Child, which completely omits his connection to the Fatui, and takes to him quickly. Meanwhile, Child himself sees bits of his little sis in Shinyan. Then they all team up and begin progressing through the domain to help Shiki Taisho regain his memory. About halfway through, Shinyan and the Traveler are teleported out of the Onmyo chamber, though it turns out it's just in time to receive the new travel permit that Sara processed personally for Shinyan. She went all out, getting it with the longest duration possible and accommodations included, all as thanks for the pyro musician's help. Shinyan can't thank Sara enough and hopes the general can catch one of her shows sometime despite her busy schedule. But there's also something else on Shinyan's mind. She quickly comes up with a story that avoids raising Sara's suspicions about the domain. Because you see, Shinyan wants Shiki Taisho to have a chance to regain his memories and prove his innocence before the Tenryou Commission launches a full raid on the domain. Remember all of Shinyan's background we covered earlier in the video? Well, it shouldn't be hard to see why she relates to the feeling of being misunderstood and judged before people have the right context about her. With that, Shinyan continues to be an incredibly supportive friend to Shiki Taisho as he deals with the uncertainty that manifests due to his slowly recovering memory. She considers them real friends, even before they reach the final revelations of the doll's background. But when the entire truth is uncovered at last, Shiki Taisho comes away able to believe there's more to his life's purpose than serving his now deceased master. His mindset is really thanks to Shinyan's encouragement this whole time, and the things she shared about her own personal adversity that she's faced along the path to her rock and roll stardom. Finally, Shinyan can tell Shiki Taisho is a little bummed about their eventual parting, now that their adventures are over. So she reassures him that she plans on paying him some regular visits now that she knows her way around Inazuma a little better. And especially since he's the newest fan of rock and roll. Then this entire event is brought to a close on Shinyan's end with none other than another cheesy mini performance. But honestly, there's no such thing as too much cheese, so I'm all for it. So we know Shiki Taisho is a big fan of rock and roll, but not everyone is. Shincho prefers to read in peace and quiet, and so does not appreciate Shinyan's raucous music, nor her ability to perform wherever she is. And even though Beto and Shinyan get along great, and her Crux crew really digs Shinyan's songs, rock and roll isn't the captain's cup of tea, funny enough. On the other hand, we know Yunjin is a big fan of Shinyan and goes to see performances at least 3 times a week. Plus, the forward-thinking Yuhong, Kuching also digs rock and roll. Yanfei was quite taken by the first of Shinyan's performances she ever encountered, and in fact, her music inspired her to give it a shot herself. Though, unfortunately, the lawyer found learning an instrument quite difficult. But the best part about this is that Yanfei decided she could just become a rapper instead, what with her extensive knowledge of vocabulary thanks to practicing law. Now, Chongyun is an interesting case since he says he avoids Shinyan's performances like the plague, since the heated atmosphere just gets him all hot and bothered. So, I don't know if this is just an interpretation that can be made from the English translation, and or perhaps I'm just thinking too much into this, but coupled with the fact that Shinyan's voiceline about Chongyun reveals that he ended up rocking out on stage with her, is this like a potential ship? Like, please don't tell me I'm the only one who's kinda curious about these contradictory statements. So if any of you have headcanons about this, please let me know in the comments. But yeah, whether this is romantic or platonic, I never really thought about the relationship between these two Liyue Claymore characters until I read both of these voice lines. And speaking of wholesome and also kind of funny, so Zhongli was one of the first ever clients to request a performance from Shinyan. And this was back when no one gave her music the time of day, so she was really excited. But when Shinyan got to the venue to perform, she was totally taken aback, because it was the Wangshang funeral parlor. She still wonders how he thought that was appropriate. Shinyan's also had some similar kooky experiences with the parlor's director. You see, Hu Tao really likes people who play with fire, since it's really good for business. I expect no less from her. But speaking of Shinyan's business, Dr. Baiju's prescriptions are a lifesaver for her voice. So she tried to give one of her impromptu performances as thanks one time, but ended up knocking out his snake. And that day, she learned that snakes are very sensitive to vibrations. But to round up Boo Boo Pharmacy's employees, Chi Chi literally just says, "Who?" when asked about Shinyan. Oh, I love my cryo daughter. Never change. But at last, we've arrived at the final section of this video. That being just some miscellaneous but important things to know about Shinyan, like her favorite food and stuff. Though, let's talk about her instrument first, since it's honestly really cool. She actually made the lyre herself, having fashioned it off the rock and roll instruments they have in Fontaine. Xinyan also adds her own personal modifications all the time, like this crescent-shaped axe blade on the tail end that can serve as a weapon just in case. It's also connected to her vision, so it can spew flames whenever, and can even self-destruct, basically, just in case it got in the wrong hands. But now we can move on to food. Xinyan loves the oily and meaty lunch at the dockyards, and no, not that kind. Meanwhile, anything bland is just no good to her. Flavors are meant to pack a punch, so if it's supposed to be salty, make it salty, and so on. And when it comes to music, she apparently doesn't reciprocate for Yunjin when it comes to opera, since she finds the stuff just too uptight with all its focus on the technical aspect of music. And remember how we talked about her skill with needlework and stuff? Well, she loves making her own stage outfits, her favorite being the one she made out of silk flowers. Though why her ascension material is violet grass, no one knows. And even though she usually gets wrapped up in the music prep zone the nights after her performances, she and Xianling can stay up pretty late chatting with each other whenever the chef can also find time off. I just love the wholesome relationship of the two youngest pyro gals from Liyue. But anyway, to wrap up the current lore, Xinyan is a true pioneer who presses on despite what others may think of her. She believes many adults are unable to reach their true potential because they're tied down by prejudice, so she weaves these topics into her songs, which she views as seeds that may eventually take root in these people's hearts. She hopes all those who listen to her rock and roll can wake up one morning realizing that their real-life troubles are nothing but a storm in a teacup. But yeah, I'd love to know if you learned anything new from this video, or if you think I missed something when it comes to Xinyan. Plus, any update videos I do for her will be linked in the pinned comment below. Also, please like the video if you liked it, and subscribe for more of this series. I already have another one of these lore guides in the works, which I'm hoping to have out next week sometime, starring Child. Also, hey, just letting you know, you can join our welcoming and friendly Discord community, and also if you like the Trails and or Persona series, I have a whole separate channel with tons of content on it dedicated to those games, so check it out if you wish. But otherwise, thanks so much for watching, guys, and until next time, take care. See ya!